passages this morning would be verses 20 and 21. The prophet Elisha fell ill with a fatal disease, and he lay dying. King Jehoash of Israel went to visit him. My father, he exclaimed as he wept. You have been the mighty defender of Israel. Get a bow and some arrows, Elisha ordered him. Jehoash got them, and Elisha told him to get ready to shoot. The king did so, and Elisha placed his hands on the king's hand. Then, following the prophet's instructions, the king opened the window that faced towards Syria. Shoot the arrow, Elisha ordered. As soon as the king shot the arrow, the prophet exclaimed, "You are the Lord's arrow with which he will win victory over Syria." Can I hear you say amen? You will fight the Syrians in Afek until you defeat them. Then Elisha told the king to take the other arrows and strike the ground with them. The king struck the ground 3 times and then stopped. This made Elisha angry, and he said to the king, "You should have struck 5 or 6 times, and then you would have won complete victory over the Syrians. But now you will defeat them only 3 times. You will not defeat them only 3 times, but you will defeat them more than 3 times. Because you will do more than 3 times. In the name of Jesus." Verse 20. Elisha died and was buried. Every year, bands of Moabites used to invade the land of Israel. Once, during the funeral, one of those bands was seen, and the people threw the corpse into Elisha's tomb and ran off. As soon as the body came into contact with Elisha's bones, the man came back to life and stood up. King Hazael of Syria oppressed the Israelites during all of Jehoash's reign, but the Lord was kind and merciful to them. He will not let them be destroyed. God will not allow you to be destroyed in the name of Jesus. But help them because of his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He has never forgotten his people. At the death of King Hazael of Syria, his son Ben-Hadad became king. Then King Jehoash of Israel defeated Ben-Hadad 3 times and recaptured the cities that had been taken by Ben-Hadad through the reign of Jehoash, the father of Jehoash. And the Lord bless the reading of his word in Jesus' name. Amen. And you will recapture what was taken from you through the power of your God, who is bigger than your enemy, in the name of Jesus. Amen. The power in the dead bone to release what is mine. The power of the dead bone to release what is what? Amen. Amen. That's what I want to talk about. Now, Jehoash ruled in Israel for about 10 years or more, or in his 10th year as the ruler of Israel. The prophet Elisha took him. And it is also said that the prophet Elisha reigned in Israel for about 65 years. That was a very long time. because he met many kings. So he had, if you like, God gave him longevity. As many of us are blessed with good life and long life. And if you don't have, God will bless you with one. And within that period, Elisha was like the eye of the nation. That's why he says, a land without the prophet, a church without the prophets, is in trouble. Just like our country is, without a guide. And you will also remember that that was the same role Elijah played during his time. That was why when Ahab was misbehaving, Elijah confronted him. That eventually made him to become a fugitive when the king's wife came after him. And then through him again, God brought about victory and the enthronement of God through the defeat of the prophets of Baal. That same role Elisha was playing. And you will remember, when Elijah was being taken up to heaven, he says something to Elisha. He says, if you will see me when I've been taken up to heaven, first, I will drop my mantle for you. And secondly, and I emphasize it, secondly, you will have a double portion of my power. Amen. Double portion of what? My power. And it is that double portion of Elijah's power that was bequeathed to Elisha that is at work today, that brought about the raising of a dead man that just touched the bones of dead Elisha. That is the fulfillment of God's power. That's why last Friday, for those of you who were here, I said, there is no promise too hard for our God to do what? Fulfill. When he says it, it comes to pass. And when God has chosen you, God bestows honors on his people. But the honors that God bestows on us are at different levels. That's why you say grace differs. Our grace differs. My grace and your grace might not be the same. You might have a particular grace which I don't have, but we, working in synergy, working together, will bring out the best of what God wants of us. One of those honors you could decipher from what we are seeing is this. Elijah was honored by God at the point of his departure. That was when he was taken by the whirlwind into heaven, and Elisha saw him, and Elisha shouted, my father, my father. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 12. Those were the words of Elisha when he saw his father taken. Now, in the opening text of our passage this morning, when the king came, when he heard that Elisha was sick, when he came, he repeated the same word that Elisha said to Elijah, my word, father, my word, my father. You will call him today, my father, my father. And when you call him, my father, he will answer you. In the name of Jesus. And so, he called him, my father, my father. Now, there is something I want to draw from that experience. Jehoshaphat had said to the people of Israel, listen to God, hear God, and obey the words of his prophets. Did you remember that? When they were to go to war, he said to the people of Israel, obey God and listen to the words of his prophets. Now, when the king came to Elisha, Elisha gave him instruction. Elisha said, pick some arrows and bring them, and I will tell you what to do. And he did. And when he did that, he told him, shoot. He shot the first, and then he said, use the other one, spin on the ground. He did the first one, the second one, and the third one, he was tired. Amen. 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 Your salvation is in your hands. Your power to be delivered is in your hands. It is you who will bring your way out. Some of you, sometimes you run from place to place. Then give me, pray for me, pray for me. You will bring your way what? Out. The measure you are able to dig out is the measure that you will carry and go. I don't know if you are you getting me? Are you following me? Those of us who depend on people, do this for us. Even in life, if you are a student, others are sleeping, others are reading, spending morning, midnight candle, you go and be sleeping and then in the morning you get 45%, the other person will get 85% because he bought midnight candle, except those who are extraordinarily dull. Also, those of you in business and even in your workplace, your promotion comes is based on the measure of the effort that you put in. And so he told him, he got angry, he said you should have done that like 6 to 7 or 8, 10 times. Meaning, the more you do, the more you give, the anointing does what increases for you. There are some persons today in the authority of coming for this program, don't be so. Don't be so. Some persons came only yesterday. If it is to be for 1 week, some people will say, but towards the end, then I will do what? I will come. As you go, each day increases your opportunities of blessing. And so if you are following God, you've got to be consistent, because it is in that consistency, which is the nature of God, that your salvation will come and your breakthrough will come. Now, the words of the prophet also came to pass for this man, because eventually he won the war, but he was able to capture 3 times. Everybody say 3 times. As his effort was able to carry him, he would have won and won and won and won and won and won, and there would be no repeats. But in our case, because Jesus is with us, you will ever live win. You will ever live victorious. And you will continue to be an overcomer in the name of Jesus. And so when he did all that, Elisha finally died. Now, when he came to Elisha, you know why he cried, "My father, my father"? Because they had looked up to Elisha as defense for the people. They forgot the God who was working with Elisha. If you go back to that chapter about verse 1, you will see the harassment from the Syrians upon the Israelites. There was this constant fight. Now, the Moabites who came, the bandits, like it's happening in Nigeria. Today we have war. Bandits, they call them bandits even when they know them. They call them unknown gunmen even when they know them. They Christianize the name. Instead of saying, "Mate Allah and Fulani Hesmen are the war bandits," they call them bandits. They know them. Now, in the old time, there were bandits. The Moabites in this case were the bandits who terrorized the Israelites, who came as invaders to distract the people, in fact to suppress and oppress them. But while Elisha was alive, they never came, because he was the seer. That's why in 2 Kings chapter 6, when the Syrians will plan, before they came to execute, God will reveal to the prophet Elisha, and Elisha will tell the king. And so the king said, "How come that the king of Israel knows my secret, even what happens in my bedroom? One of you is sabotaging." He said, "No, there is a seer, there is a prophet, there is a visioner amongst the Israelites who even hears you when you cough." Amen. And when you cough, he tells the king. When you wake up, he tells the king. That's why Psalm 139 says, "Where can we hide from the Lord?" From where? He said, if you go up there, he is what? There. If you go down, he is what? There. If you say, "Let the earth cover you," he is even there, is not hidden from what? God. And that's why today you see the Spirit of God followed the body of the dead man to the grave and brought him up. Amen. Amen. And so, with that, they were not able to defeat the Israelites. And so this man had to cry when Elisha was to die, or when Elisha died. But my dear friends, when God raised the dead body of that man by the fact of just touching Elisha's body, God was proving one or two things. First, God was telling the people, yes, Elisha is dead. Do not follow Elisha. There is the God of Elisha and the God of what? Elijah, who is not dead. But this man, not the God of Elisha. Okay, what is your name? Basi. This time, we are talking about the God of Basi. We are talking about the God of Chijoke. We are talking about the God of Fadaben, who gives him life and who gives you life. God again is telling us, stop following servants of God. Stop running after prophets. Stop running after healers, because they are not the source of the power. The source of the power is behind. And that is the God you look up to. And that's why the word of God says, God is not the God of the dead, but the God of the world, the living. The prophet had died, but the power did not die, because that power did not depend on him and did not come from him. Some of you are busy running after mommy this, daddy this, daddy that. You forget the God of the prophets. I think recently one prophet in Nigeria died, or two or three of them. Huh? Who did that? Huh? G.B. James. Joshua. And Akiola. But God has not died. So stop running after them. God is telling us, focus on me. He was telling the Israelites, focus on what? Me, because I'm a promise keeper. And so when the prophet died, the Syrians felt that Israel was defenseless.
But Israel was not defenseless. Some think that you are defenseless. But you are not defenseless. Your defender is alive. Because the psalmist says, my God neither sleeps nor walks, so does. When every other person is sleeping, your God is what? Alive. Amen. Now Elisha died. And when he died, he was buried. Again, look at this. Every one of us is a subject of death. Every one of us is prone to what? Death. But Abel will die. You will die. Bishop will die. Pope will do what? Die. Stop being afraid of death, but prepare for what? Death. Secondly, the healer also does what? Dies. The healer also does what? Dies. When his time is up. There is one body who is a superman. No matter they carry for a man today, maybe as we are doing this program, one dead person is running and will pray and doesn't get up. Does not mean that we will not die. Even if you are the greatest healer that exists on this earth, the person will do what? Jesus Christ has sanctified the grave and made it a place of passage through life eternal. But Jesus says, for those who believe in me, even if they die, they have the reward, they will live what? Forever. So we should have a hope. So when Elijah died, he was buried. and he was sleeping in the peace of death. And then on this fateful day, another fellow, another Israelite dies. This is the fate of our today. He dies. And they prepare to go and bury him. And because the Baptists know that the defender of Israel, the seer of Israel, the prophet of Israel, have passed on. And so they returned their harassment on the people. As they are going about doing that, now the men prepare to go and bury the dead man. And as they scurry away, the Baptists shock. Everybody say, the Baptists shock. And because of fear, they did not get to the exact grave where the man should be buried, because every person had a grave. I have my own grave. Amen. Except Jesus borrowed a grave for somebody. Each of us have a grave, 6 feet allotted to us. That man was being carried to be buried in his own grave. They carried him. The bodies struck. And when they struck, they could not get to the exact grave where they want to bury him, but they dropped him in the grave of Elisha. Power. Everybody say power. And when they dropped him there, and ran away, a very renowned writer known as Josephus, who chronicled everything about the Israelites and the Old Testament, he said that was not an action, not an action that he died, but he was an honorable man who was on his way traveling. He encountered chiefs who robbed him and killed him, and then threw his body into the grave of Elisha. And when they did that, the man got up. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Whether chiefs or whether he died, but the fact is that he did what? He rose. He came back alive. Now, first of all, who caused the destruction? There was a destruction. Badness caused what? Destruction. Child of God, I tell you this morning, God positioned the badness. God positioned the destruction so that the man will not be buried where they wanted to bury him, but rather they threw him into a place where he has positioned a helper for him. Elohim positioned the bones of Elisha to be his what? Helper. Amen.
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 Child of God. Some people have brought in their back for. Two of us. I think. Some people have brought in that you will not cross you. Wrong, and your eyes are just shining. They have said, by Jew, if you leave, don't call me a man. But you don't even know that that is their plan. And along the line, God does something, and the person is taken out, and you're still living. They have set accident for you on the road, and you're traveling. Before you get to the position, the car you are inside stops somewhere. And by the time it is the day, then they repair the car. This man, I'm a fucking angel. This man, they pursue you, you will not fall. Because there is a God that you are serving. Sometimes do not see the bad things that happen to you as evil. God allows uses bad things sometimes to bring about good. If there were no bandits that came, the Moabite bandits that came to steal and to scare the people, they would have gently and coolly taken the man to the exact grave where he would be buried. They would bury him, cover the sand, and do what? And do what? And go. And what happens? The man will rot him. It's not your portion. You will not rot him. That grave they dug for you, you will miss it. That grave will come back. God will cause a destruction, and you will not be in that.
of your spirit will return.
Your life wire, is not functioning anymore. But child of God, the Lord is telling us today, He wants to give you victory in every situation. That is what God is saying. In the midst of the turmoil, in the midst of the trouble, in the midst of the sadness of that family, they carry
so that at the end, when the prayer of consecration is said, you become the firebrand minister of God. Consecrated.
Again, that again brings us to some awareness. Some of you, anybody that comes, you are already laying hands on you. Why?
That there is some power to you. Both black power and black power, any kind of power, they do what? Transfer. Where you are pushing miracles, or where you are pushing men, you think have power to do miracles.
So, what are suffering? What we do not know because of some powers that have been projected to us, and those powers keep ruling your life. But today, my dear friends, God will help you to be resurrected and revived in the name of Jesus. Elisha. Through God can also bless the woman who had given him large gin in her house. Said, what shall I do to this woman? What will I do to make her the woman of the Shunammite woman? Elijah was the woman of Zarephath, whose son he also prayed, and God gave that child back to him, gave that woman child. But eventually the child died. And Elijah said, the woman began to accuse Elijah, you know, God's curse upon me and my family. Elijah went and laid on that boy, took him to his room and laid upon him, and power transferred and he came back. Then in the case of Elijah, the Shunammite woman's son, whom he had prayed to God and God gave the woman the son, died. The woman went after the prophet of God, he came. And when he came, Elisha laid on that boy. In the scriptures, he said, he laid upon him eye to what? Eye. Nose to what? Nose. Mouth to what? Mouth. And when he did that, life returned to the boy. And the boy sneezed 7 times. And 7 means completion. God's miracle for your life will be complete in the name of Jesus. When he sneezed that number of times, the boy came alive and he took her to the mother and she said, where there is the resurrection, where there is the revival, where there is the peace, joy will return. That's why this month will be the month of hope. Oh my God, a month of joy for you in the church. Jesus touched the casket of a boy who was being led out to be buried. In Luke's Gospel, chapter 7, from verse 1, from verse 11 to 17. And there was the resurrection. The power, he touched the casket and he transferred the power of resurrection onto that body. And they opened it. And the boy did what? He came out. Remember, your good, your destiny, the plans signs of progress for you that I have covered by the power of God, by the power of resurrection. That place that was covered will open. You will give a word, and that power within it will open. It will vomit your favor. It will vomit your blessing. That which God has designed for you will return to you in the name of Jesus. I'm trying to sign this so that you will also believe in the God you serve. Lazarus was another man who experienced the power in the world, the power in Jesus. He died, spent 4 days in the grave, and Jesus came and spoke to him, calling by his name, Barnabas, Thomas. And the grave did what? The grave did what? Did the grave resist? The power of riches cannot resist the power of God. Your occultic power cannot resist the power of God. The magic power cannot resist the power of God. The power that has bottled you up in a bottle cannot resist the power of God. That bottle will break. That spiritual bottle we are engaged in, we do what? Pray. In the name of Jesus. Did a prayer for one young man who joined cause and made money through it. Was thinkingly rich, but at the point things can be somehow, and he began to seek the face of God. Father prayed for him. And after that prayer, there was something they did in the occultic world and gave to him, and in that bottle, it was a bottle. They used a small crucifix of Jesus and put it inside that bottle and caught it. How the crucifix entered the heaven knows. Amen. When the heat came, when it got to the point that there was no more resistance, he made a confession to the Father and he brought the bottle. And he stayed in the way and he brought back the bottle and he showed me cross inside a bottle. This is how they teach people sometimes. But eventually they had to pray and that bottle broke. And when the bottle broke, that man crashed from top to what? God. He was begging for food. He was begging money to eat. And then Father was helping him. They kept praying and praying. Then things normalized. He eventually found his way out of the country. Today he is doing well. Last year, no, year before last, that's before the coronavirus, that young man, I think he's in Germany, invited Father, paid his flight fare to Germany, and then paid his flight fare to about 2-3 countries. It was from Germany, the Father went to Poland, and then from there, he went flew to the U.S. That young man paid his trip all through. That's the power of God's resurrection. You might be crying. Your cry won't end. Just trust God. You've been caged. The cage was made by human hands. But your God is greater than human hands. The people who were going to bury that man, they were going with the hope and the expectation that they are going to bury their brother and give him a befitting burial. For God had a different plan. Those who are plotting your downfall, let them plan. The apostles of Jesus defended the resurrection in the life of people to the point that, just before I go further, my dear friends, see, when the Lord says, I will send you the Holy Spirit who will live with you, who will abide with you, is to give us points of resurrection. I'm supposed to be a point of resurrection. You're supposed to be a point of resurrection. You're supposed to be a point of life for someone. When they come in contact with you, when he comes, he says, he will teach you everything that Jesus has said, and he will give you wisdom. And when he gives you this wisdom, you will become a soul winner. How many of us are soul winners? When people meet you, do they get new joy and happiness? Some of us go about sowing seeds of this God. Some of us are products of wickedness in our world today. When people meet us, sometimes they die. Because of what we emit is wickedness, bitterness, hatred, greed, avarice, betrayals. That's what we emit. But when they met the prophet of God, even in death, he emitted what? Life. Search your soul. Am I a point of life for someone? Does my life give meaning to someone? Has somebody abandoned God because of me? If it is, then there is a problem somewhere. But in this case, just like the woman Tabitha in Acts of the Apostles, or otherwise known as Dorcas, when she died, and I think Peter came there to pray for her and she got back life. People showed the clothes she made, those who benefited from her were away, and said, she is our hope. Are you a hope to someone? When Elijah was about to die, the king just came and said, my father, are you leaving us? Who will be our defender? Who will be our seer? But the man of God said to him, do not worry, I am just going. God will take care of him. God will take care of us. Your hope will not depend on somebody. In the name of Jesus. And our friends, without they were able to bring that woman back to life. Jesus brought Zacchaeus back, Lazarus back to life. And then, the capping of it all was the fact that Jesus died on the cross, and he resurrected, and he made a path of death a source of life for many. That whatever was buried must be released. Your God is a God of power. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 20, you meet Paul. When he was preaching and preaching late into the night, a young man by the name Eustus was hanging on the window, and from that window he eventually dozed off and he did what? Fell and he died. Amen. Was Paul not in trouble by that very fact? He gathered the people and he made someone to do what? That. But God does not abandon his own. Paul went, stretched himself over that man, and he came back to him, and he brought him, and they celebrated. Amen. Amen. Finally, in Ezekiel chapter 37, the lying of the dry bones. The bones died, the human beings died. They were buried. Some of them were buried, some were not buried. Well, when they died, I want us to get this very clear. God took his prophet Ezekiel to the valley of the dry bones, just like many of us. I know there are some of us who see themselves as dry bones that have no life again in them.
the way you see yourself. Today, you will see that you are not dry. And after all, you are alive. It does not matter the words someone has spoken over your head and about you. But what matters is that your God is what? Alive. As God will always be, he took his prophet to the valley of the dry bones and he said to him, "Son of man, can these bones live again?" The man of the prophet of God, who is a man of faith, trust, and belief, and dependence on God, said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone do us well, knows, only you knows, whether those bones will live again." And then the Lord said to him, "Prophesy to the dry bones." And he prophesied, and when he spoke the word to them, he said, the bones began to jive. Hey, the bones began to do what? Jive. He said he had a noise. You can imagine from here, to the Ikole Road, to UST, keep going, bones everywhere. And just by the spoken word of the prophet, the bones began to do what? Joy. In split seconds, he said, "To their mighty army." Mighty what? Army. Just like this army of children of God gathered here this morning. If your bone is dry, by the spoken word that I speak to you as a prophet of God, I bring a revival to your life in the name of Jesus. I don't know who may have disconnected and broken your bone, but what I believe and what I stand is that the word of God is alive and what? Active. It costs more instantly than war, the two-edged sword. Every secret thing that has been done, every secret wind that is blowing your windpipe, that wind will cease in the name of Jesus Christ. Yes, you've been dying, you died in the spirits, and you're no longer alive. Let the Spirit of God arise and locate you in that place, this day and this moment, as you sit and stand on this consecrated ground to the Lord in the name of Jesus.
he said they became a huge army. A huge army that no nation and nobody could stand. When God resurrects you, you become formidable. You will become formidable. Every severe spirit following you. Every severe spirit pursuing you. You will conquer them. In the name of Jesus. Can I see you stand?
You must go to the grave.